Ano ho ba ang ibig sabihin ni prospectivity? Prospectivity means our criminal law will not undertake to punish act when during the commission of that act, it is not yet punishable. Hi! Hello! Welcome again mga katrupa sa YouTube channel po natin. Medyo matagal-tagal po tayong hindi nakikita considering na ang inyong lingkod po medyo busy po ng konti sa school po where I am connected. But at anyhow, I am glad and happy to see you all again in our YouTube channel. Welcome to this Criminology Gabay Kaalaman. Again, I am your Criminology Coach, Coach Ed Montalba. So guys, ang pag-uusapan po natin sa araw na to, we will try to discuss some of the subjects under the area of criminal jurisprudence. Yes, we will be discussing some law subjects today. But guys, before I will proceed, I just would like to clarify na ang inyong lingkod po ay hindi po isang abogado. I may not be in the right position to discuss this topic with you. And of course, lawyers can explain this topic better than me. But the very purpose of these video clips or educational vlog is only to augment your knowledge acquired in your classroom. So, uumpisahan po natin ang topic natin today with Criminal Law Book 1. So, we will define first on what is a criminal law. Criminal law, it is a branch or division of public law which defines crimes, each of their nature, and provides for their punishment. Guys, based on that definition, it is obvious that criminal law is only one of those many branches of our public laws. Marami po palang branches yung public laws po natin. You have administrative law, you have political law, you have commercial law, and so on and so forth. And out of that many branches of public laws, isa po doon si criminal law. But how will you able to know whether or not that law, paano po natin malalaman na yung batas na yon ay criminal law? There are three things that we have to remember. There are three things that you have to consider in determining whether or not that law is a criminal law. Number one, dapat that law must define crime. Ibig sabihin po, you will know that law is a criminal law. Pag nag-a-identify po yung batas na yon ng isang krimen or it defines a particular act as a crime. Second, traits of their nature. When that law discusses on how this act will be committed, on how this crime will be committed, on what are the elements of this act so that this act will become punishable. Okay? And finally, number three, that law must provide punishment or penalty to the crime that has been defined by this law. So, yung tatlo po yon, it defines crime, traits of their nature, and provide for their punishment. So, malalaman natin na yung batas na yon ay isang criminal law if that law defines crime, traits of their nature, and it provides penalty. Okay? So, guys, the very focus of criminal law is crime. That is why, in the study of criminal law, we will be discussing about the relationship of law and crime. So, ano po pala si crime? Crime can be legally defined as an act committed or omitted in violation of criminal law forbidding or commanding it. Okay? So, yung definition po pala ng crime, crime is a general terms that refers to those acts which are punishable by a criminal law. But guys, based on that definition, crimes can be committed in two different ways. It can be committed by means of action And it can also be committed by means of omission. Ano po ang pagkakaiba ni action at saka omission? Because as what I have said, there are two different ways that a person might commit a crime. It is by means of action or by means of omission. Ano ho ba ang pagkakaiba ni action at saka omission? Pag sinasabi po nating action, that refers to any bodily movement. Okay? May ginagawa po. You are doing, you are performing something. Pag sinasabi po nating omission, meaning inaction, doing nothing. Wala po kayong ginawa. In other words, pwede palang makomit ang isang krimen even the person is doing nothing. And that is a crime by means of omission. But mind you guys, most of our crimes can be committed by means of action. However, there are some provisions of the revised penal code that penalizes omission and defines such omission as crime. Okay? What are the example? Example is misprision of treason. Diba yung if there is a conspiracy against the government, if a person is aware that somebody or a Filipino citizen is conspiring each other to commit the crime of treason, and the other person who is aware that there was a conspiracy that transpires among these people and he fails to report that one to the proper judicial authorities. So pag nalalaman po pala ng isang tao na may nagko-conspire against the government that they are about to commit or perpetuate the crime of treason, and that person fails to report that one to the proper judicial authorities, then that person can be charged for doing nothing. He or she can be charged with the crime of misprision of treason. Aside from misprision of treason, you have also abandoning of minors, abandoning of a dying or wounded person found in an inhabited place. Yung may nakikita ka na a person who is about to die or a person who is wounded, and you happen to saw that person in an uninhabited place, meaning yung mga lugar na walang katao-tao, your failure to help that person, that dying or wounded person, will constitute crime called omission. And more specifically, that is what we call crime of abandoning wounded or dying person found in an inhabited place. Okay? So, crimes can also be classified according to law that punishes it. And of course, I am referring to the legal classification of crime. Okay? So, may mga classification din po tayo sa krimen in as far as the legal aspect is concerned. Number one, may tinatawag po tayong felony. Number two, may tinatawag po tayong offense. And third, may tinatawag po tayong infraction or infraction of ordinance. How does these three crimes differ to each other? Pag sinasabi po nating felony, that refers to a crime that is punishable under the revised penal code. If that act is punishable under the revised penal code, ang tawag po pala sa krimen na yon, ang tawag po natin dyan ay felony. However, if the crime is punishable under special laws, ang tawag po natin dyan is offense. Okay? Ano-ano po yung mga special laws? Special laws refers to those laws enacted by Congress, yung mga Republic Act, which are penal in nature. So if the violation of the person po pala is in violation of a certain Republic Act, then ang tawag po sa krimen na yon is offense. Ano ba yung pangatlo? Yung infraction of ordinance. Okay? Infraction is sometimes called misdemeanor. These are minor offenses. These are offenses that is in violation of a municipal or city ordinance. Yung, if a person happens to commit or violate a certain municipal ordinance to which that ordinance provides penalty or provides imprisonment or punishes certain act, then ang tawag po natin sa krimen na yan is infraction of ordinance. Now, crime can also be classified as to mala in se and mala prohibita. Okay? Siguro po, you are very familiar with this. If you are already a graduate or nagre-review na po kayo ngayon, alam nyo po yung ano yung mala in se at saka mala prohibita. Pero, i-review po natin. We have to clarify on what is the basic distinction between the mala in se and the mala prohibita. Ano po ang ibig sabihin ng mala in se or malum in se? Okay, mala in se kasi that is plural of malum in se. Mala in se, these are crimes which are evil in itself. These are crimes which are inherently evil. Ibig sabihin po, ito po yung mga krimen na even before it is already considered as crime. However, there are certain acts that this act or acts are not punishable before. But as time passes by, okay, as time passes by, this certain act has been regulated by the government. The government imposes penalty or punishment on this particular act. Yun ho ang tinatawag po natin mala prohibita. Okay? Or mala prohibito. Meaning, that particular act has become a crime by statute. Or the government said that they are crimes. These are acts which are not punishable before, but now it has become punishable. That is why most of the crimes which has been considered as mala in se. Balikan natin si mala in se. Yung mala in se, most of the crimes na mala in se ay doon po natin makikita sa revised penal code. Pero yung mga mala prohibita po, these crimes are made punishable under penal special laws sa mga Republic Act po. Okay? So yun ho ang pagkakaiba ni mala in se at saka ni mala prohibita. Again, pag sinasabi po nating mala in se, these are crimes which are inherently evil or evil in itself. Pag sinasabi po nating mala prohibita, these are crimes that has become crime simply because the government said that they are crimes. It is considered crime because there is law that punishes that act. So ano-ano po ba ang mga example ng crimes by means of mala in se or crimes called mala in se? Okay? Siyempre, as what I have said, yun po yung crimes which are inherently evil. Even before, this is already crime. Ano-ano po to? Rape, murder, robbery, theft. Okay? So, these crimes are of course penalized under the revised penal code. So, what are the examples of a crime called mala prohibita? Okay? As what I have said, these are crimes which are not punishable before, but it has become punishable today because the government needs to control this act. What are the example? Example, the crime called illegal logging, illegal fishing. These are some of the many examples of crimes called mala prohibita. Illegal fishing before is not a crime. When you do fishing, you will use dynamite, okay, for you to catch fish. It was not crime before. Pero nakita ng gobyerno that this certain acts needs to be regulated because it will damage the coral reef. What else? Illegal logging. Illegal logging before is not a crime. You can even cut trees. You are free to do it. But today, you are not even allowed to cut your own trees. Okay? You need permit for you to cut it. Why? Because you can be charged with illegal logging. because it is penalized by the government. Yun ho ang example po natin sa mala prohibita and mala insa. So ngayon, dadako po tayo sa sources of criminal law. Saan ho ba makikita ang criminal law? What are the different sources of our criminal law? Okay? Of course, the number one source of our criminal law is the Revised Penal Code. Second, penal special laws. Ano po yung mga penal special laws? Ito ho yung mga batas that has been enacted or created by Congress. Ito ho yung mga Republic Acts. Pag sinasabi po nating Congress, of course, we are referring to both houses. Yung Congress po natin sa Pilipinas, considering na ang inaadap po natin na system of Congress in our country is bicameral. Meaning two, there are two bodies. We have the upper house and you have the lower house. Pag sinasabi po nating upper house, we must be referring to the House of Senate. Pag sinasabi po nating lower house, yun ho ang tinatawag natin na House of Representatives. Or nandito po yung mga congressmen po natin. Okay? So that is the second source of our criminal or penal special laws. The third one, presidential decrees. Okay? Ano po ba yung presidential decrees? Ang ibig ho bang sabihin that the president can enact laws? So to speak, the president cannot enact laws. Okay? Because the power, the duty to enact laws that is vested in Congress. So the president cannot enact laws. Pero sir, sino ho ba ang gumagawa ng mga presidential decrees? Well, it's the president. So sir, di ba ho sabi nyo po, hindi po pwede ang presidente that can enact laws? Yes. But when the state or if our country is under martial law, then the president can enact laws. Okay? So meaning, yung mga presidential decrees po natin sa ngayon, these are laws enacted during the time martial law, specifically during the time of former President Marcos. So what are the other sources of our criminal law other than the Revised Penal Code, the penal special laws, the presidential decrees? And number four there, laws enacted during National Assembly. Yun hong tinatawag po natin na BP or Batas Pambansa. Okay? Siguro po, the most common BPs, no, in the study of criminology si BP 22, yung anti-vouching check law. And of course, that is penal in nature, but that law was enacted during National Assembly. Okay? So for now, apat po ang binibigay ko po na mga sources ng criminal law. There might be some other sources, but the basic one, ito lang po, the Revised Penal Code, the Penal Special Laws, the Presidential Decrees, or the Presidential Decree, and of course, those laws enacted during National Assembly or mga batas pambansa po. Now, kanina po, pinag-uusapan po natin yung Congress that they are responsible in enacting laws. Guys, if you can still recall, our government has three co-equal branches of our government. What are they? You have the legislative, the executive, and the judiciary. Okay? So ano po ang relationship ng tatlong branches of the government in as far as law is concerned? Guys, remember that in as far as making and enacting laws is concerned, it is the sole duty of Congress or the legislative branch of the government because the legislative power is vested in Congress. Yung mga senador po at saka mga congressmen po natin, sila po ang gumagawa ng batas. Okay? Now, let us assume that yung Congress, yung senador at saka mga congressmen po natin has already enacted laws. So what is now the role of the executive branch of the government in as far as the law that has been created or enacted by Congress? Well, it is the duty of the executive branch of the government to implement and enforce the law which has been enacted or created by Congress or the legislative branch of the government. Remember that the executive power is vested in the office of the president. Ang presidente po natin ang nasa executive branch of the government. Okay? So it is the executive branch of the government having a task, having a duty to implement and enforce the law that has been enacted by Congress. So ano po ang role ng judiciary, the third branch of the government? The judiciary or the judicial branch of the government is responsible in interpreting the law. Okay? So, when the executive branch of the government will file a case against a particular person for allegedly violating some provisions or provision of the law which has been enacted by Congress, ang gagawin po ng executive branch of the government is to bring this one to the third branch of the government, which is the judiciary. The judicial power is vested in the Supreme Court and some other courts. So therefore, yung court po pala, si judiciary po pala, ang mag-i-interpret, they are responsible in determining whether or not that this person has violated the law which has been enacted by Congress and implemented by the executive branch of the government. Yun ho ang relationship between or amongst the three branches of the government. Isasum up po natin, isusummarize po natin para maintindihan po natin yung tatlong branches of the government in relation to law. Si legislative branch, they are responsible in enacting laws. Sila po ang gumagawa ng batas. After Congress enacted laws, it is the duty of the executive branch of the government to implement and enforce that law. Lastly, the role of the judiciary is to interpret. It is the judicial branch of the government that will determine whether or not the law that has been enacted by Congress and enforced by the executive branch of the government has been violated by a particular person that has been charged in court. So now guys, balikan ho natin yung legislative branch of the government. Di ho ba na pag-uusapan natin na it is the duty of this branch of the government to enact laws. They are responsible in making laws. But guys, Congress has certain limitations in the enactment of laws. Ano-ano po itong mga limitations? Apat po ang tandaan natin. First, it must be general in character. Dapat ho pala, when Congress will enact laws, the law that they have to be enacted, it must be applicable to the general public. Hindi po pwede that Congress will enact laws that this law will only apply to a particular or group of people. Dapat ho pala, when Congress will enact laws, the law that they have to enact must be applicable to all people. That is the first limitation. Second, it must not partake of a nature of an ex post facto law. Ano po ba yung tinatawag po natin ex post facto law? One of the good example of ex post facto law is makes criminal an act done before the passage of the law. Meaning, you are imposing, you are making that particular act as a crime when during the commission of that act, it is not yet. Hindi po pwede yung batas na gagawin ng Kongreso magpapanish po ng previous act. Okay? So that is one of the example of what we call ex post facto law. In fact, in your notes perhaps class, there are basically six example of an ex post facto law. I am encouraging you guys to read and familiarize these 6 instances of unexposed facto law. Okay? So, the third one, ano po yung pangatlong limitation of the lawmaking body to enact laws? It must not partake of the nature of bill of attainder. Ano po ang ibig sabihin ng bill of attainder? Well, bill of attainder is punishing a person without the benefits of trial. Hindi po pwede na yung Congress natin gagawa ng isang batas that yung nakagawa ng isang krimen, diretso na po, wala ng trial-trial. Hindi po pwede yan. Okay? So that is the third limitation of the lawmaking body to enact laws. And of course, guys, finally, Congress are not supposed to enact laws or impose cruel or unusual punishment or excessive fines. Okay? When Congress will impose a certain punishment, they are supposed to design it, to design the punishment in the most humane way. So guys, again, uulitin po natin, there are 4 basic limitations of the lawmaking body. What are they? Number 1, it must be general in application. Second, it must not partake of the nature of an unexposed facto law. Third, it must not partake of the nature of a bill of attainder. And of course, finally, number 4, it must not impose cruel or unusual punishment or impose excessive fines. So okay, yun ho ang limitation ng lawmaking bodies to enact laws. So I hope klaro po yun, guys. So now, let us proceed to the characteristics of our criminal law. Ano-ano ho ba yung mga characteristics or katangian ng ating criminal law? Okay? Pag sinasabi pong characteristics, tatlo lang ho ang tandaan natin dyan. Okay? There are 3 characteristics of our criminal law. Number 1, generality. Number 2, territoriality. Number 3, prospectivity. General, territorial, prospective. Balikan po natin si generality. Ano ho ba ang ibig sabihin ng generality? Generality means that our criminal law is applicable to all people living or sojourning in the Philippine archipelago. Ang batas po natin is applicable to all people who are in the Philippines. Living or sojourning. Living connotes something permanent. Meaning to say, these are people that will permanently stay or live in the Philippines. And of course, we are referring to all the Filipino citizens. Sojourning means, this refers to those persons who will just temporarily stay in our country. Okay? Foreigners, for example. So, our law will apply po pala kahit hindi Filipino as long as that person is within our territory. Okay? So, yun po si generality. Again, uulitin ko po. Pag sinasabi po nating generality, ang batas po natin ay applicable po sa lahat ng mga tao na nandito sa ating teritoryo o nandito sa Pilipinas. However, guys, there are also certain persons that are exempted from the application of our criminal law. In other words, there are certain exceptions to generality. Ano-ano po yung mga exceptions? Okay, sino-sino po ba sila? Number 1, those persons covered under the principle of public international law. Yung mga tao po that covered under public international law. Ano po yung public international law? Public international law, ito po yung mga batas. Ito po yung mga agreement. Ito po yung mga napagkasunduan ng mga world leaders po natin during conventions. Whatsoever agreement that they will have during summit, it will become a public international law. And under such agreement, it has been agreed that head of states, ambassadors, and other diplomatic officials are exempted from the application of a criminal law in a particular country. Ibig sabihin po, pag may isang head of state, pag may presidente po coming from the other country and he or she will visit our country and that person happens to commit a crime while in the Philippines, our law will not apply to that person. Why? Because under public international law, they are exempted. Aside from the head of state, you have of course ambassadors. So yung mga ambassadors po from different countries who are in our country, hindi po pwede na yung batas po natin mag-a-apply sa kanila. Okay? Head of states, ambassadors, charge d'affaires, and other diplomatic officials. Except consuls. Hindi po kasali si consul sa mga exempted under public international law. So again, under the exception number one is those covered under public international law. Second, those covered under laws of preferential application. Okay? Yung mga tao that are covered under our laws on preferential application. There are certain government officials in our country that they cannot be sued upon. You cannot charge that person criminally. Under Article 6, Section 11 of the Philippine Constitution provides that members of Congress cannot be charged with the crime of libel even though they are stating some libelous statement while in session. Hindi po pwede na i-charge po natin yung mga congressmen po natin, yung senador po natin, ng kaso na libel when they are uttering these words or libelous statement while in session. So, hindi po pwede, you cannot charge. Okay? You cannot charge members of Congress because they will enjoy the so-called parliamentary immunity. Okay? So, hindi po sila pwedeng kasuhan. And of course, the last and the third exception of the general application of our criminal law, those persons who are covered under treaties or treaty stipulation. So ano po yung treaties or treaty stipulation? Treaty or treaty stipulation refers to agreement between two nations, between two countries. Okay? If there is a treaty, if there is that agreement that gives immunity to a particular person, then that treaty will prevail. So, hindi po pwede na we will file a criminal case against that person or a particular person if it is covered under the agreement of two nations. Okay? So, that is all about generality po. Okay? Let's proceed to the second characteristics of our criminal law. The second characteristic of our criminal law is territoriality. Ano po ang ibig sabihin ng territoriality? Madali lang po yan. From the word territorial, meaning to say, our law, our criminal law is applicable within the territory of our country. So yung batas po pala natin is to be applied anywhere in the Philippines, any territory of the Philippines. So ano-ano po yung composition ng territory po natin sa Pilipinas? Okay? Of course, we have the terrestrial territory, you have the fluvial territory, and the aerial territory. So, terrestrial, fluvial, and aerial. Pag sinasabi po nating terrestrial, that refers to the bodies of lands o yung mga kalupaan po natin. Pag sinasabi po nating fluvial, meaning to say, our bodies of waters. So, pag sinasabi po nating fluvial, tandaan natin, yung waters po na included sa territory natin, that is to include interior waters and exterior waters. Interior, ibig sabihin po yung mga waters po nandito po sa loob, no, such as rivers, lakes, and so on and so forth. Pag sinasabi po nating exterior waters, we are of course referring to our oceans. Okay, oceans within our territory. All crimes, therefore, guys, that will be committed within our territory is triable under our court. Yun ho ang ibig sabihin ng territoriality po. But however, guys, the territorial application of our criminal law has also certain exceptions. There are times that our law will be applicable even those crimes committed outside our territory. May mga pagkakataon po na yung batas po natin ay mag-a-apply even those crimes committed outside our territory. Diba yung general rule, as far as territoriality is concerned, our law will only apply to those crimes committed within our territory. However, guys, there are certain instances that our law will still apply even those crimes committed outside our country. And that is what we call the extraterritorial application of our law. Okay? As to scope po pala, okay? As to scope of the applicability of our law, it can be applied intraterritorially and it can also be applied extraterritorially. Okay? Pag sinasabi po nating intra, meaning it can be applied within our territory. Pag sinasabi po nating extraterritorial application, in certain cases, it can be applied even those crimes committed outside our country. So ano-ano po yung mga instances po that our criminal law will apply even those crimes committed outside our territory? Well, Article 2 of the Revised Penal Code provides. Andon po yung mga 5 instances that our law will apply even those crimes are committed beyond our territory. Diba? Should commit an offense while in the Philippine ship or airship, should forge or counterfeit Philippine currency note, should be liable in the introduction into these islands, any of the articles mentioned in the preceding paragraph. 4th is while being a public official, should commit an offense in connection or in line with their functions. And number 5, should commit an offense in violation of Title 1, Book 2 of the Revised Penal Code, yung crimes against national security and the law of nations. Okay? But anyway, we will be discussing in our next video clips about these 5 instances wherein which our law is to be applied even committed outside our territory, when we will try to discuss Article 2 of the Revised Penal Code. Okay? So for now, let us proceed with the 3rd characteristics of our criminal law, which is prospectivity. Okay? Tapos na tayo sa generality, tapos na po tayo sa territoriality. Puntahan po natin si prospectivity. Ano ho ba ang ibig sabihin ni prospectivity? Prospectivity means our criminal law will not undertake to punish act when during the commission of that act, it is not yet punishable. Hindi po pwede na yung batas po natin ay magpapunish ng isang act that during the commission of that act, it is not yet punishable. In other words, the applicability of our criminal law is to be applied proactively, not retroactively. Paabanti po ang applicability ng batas natin. Hindi po pwede na yung bagong batas will cover acts that has been previously committed. Our law, as far as its effectivity is concerned, it will be effective from the date of its effectivity onwards. Okay? And the only exception of that principle is that the only time that the law will be applied retroactively is when the new law is favorable to the accused. Just in case po na yung bagong batas is favorable. Say for example, the new law is trying to reduce penalty of a certain crime, then that new law will apply even those persons that has been convicted with that previous law gives higher penalty. So pwede po yung bagong batas iaatras po considering that the new law is favorable to the accused. Okay? So guys, these are the 3 characteristics of our criminal law. What are they? Number 1, general, which means our law is applicable to all people living or sojourning in the Philippines. 2nd, you have territoriality, meaning to say our law is applicable or enforceable within our territory. And finally, number three po is prospectivity, meaning to say, the applicability of our law, it is to be applied proactively, not retroactively. Okay? So, to cut it short, ang tandaan po natin, pag sinasabi po nating generality, ang pinag-uusapan po natin doon ay tao. Our law is applicable to all people. Pag sinasabi po nating territoriality, ang pinag-uusapan po natin ay lugar. Okay? Our law is applicable within the territory of the Philippines. And finally, pag sinasabi po nating prospective or prospectivity, ang pinag-uusapan po natin is time. Time of its applicability. Panahon. It will not be applied retroactively. It will be applied proactively. Guys, those are the three basic characteristics of our criminal law. Guys, I hope that you learn something from this educational vlog. So guys, yan lang muna for now, okay? So, I will try to do my best to upload more videos. Yung hindi pa po nakapag-subscribe, please do subscribe. And please do not forget to click the notification bell so that updated po kayo every time na mag-upload po tayo ng videos po natin. I am also encouraging you to please like my FB page, Edwin T. Montalba FB page. Please do like and follow me there. Okay? So guys, thank you for your time. I hope that you are safe and you are in good condition at the moment. Again po, this is your criminology coach, Coach Ed Montalba. God bless you all.